David. Luke chapter 15. Get your Bible out. Luke chapter 15. 15. Yeah. I get the little twang. Runs me back home, man. If you ain't got a Bible, let me have you get a Bible in your hand. The most precious book on this planet. One amazing thing I heard a preacher preach this week said, we have the mind of God in our hand. The mind of God is in our hand. Now, there's a lot of stuff God has not revealed. There's a lot of stuff that God has not told us. But everything He wants us to know is in this book right here. And man, there's a reason they were going to try to cancel it. There's a reason they've always tried to cancel it. It ain't new. And cancel culture now, they've always tried to burn this book up and get rid of it. They can't do it. All the way can't do it. Man, you just put a bunch of gas on fire in there, Brother Bryce. That's good. All right, Luke chapter 15. Today we're going to, part two, I got to do one more part though. You got to come back. Maybe not next week, but the week after I do part three. We got to look at the other son. I didn't have time. There was too much in this passage for us to get it all in. I didn't want to rush it. I wanted to try to take my time and preach through this. But we are looking tonight at the homecoming. At the homecoming. So, chapter 15, everybody look at verse, we're starting verse 20. It says, Luke chapter 15, verse 20. We'll do a recap of what we did last week, just in case you weren't here. So he rose and came to his father, but when he was yet a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion. Thought I'd get a little farther than this and doing that. And ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. The son said unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven, and in thy sight no more worthy to be called thy son. But the father said to his servants, bring forth the best robe, and put it on him, and put a ring on his hand, and shoes on his feet, and bring hither the fatted calf, and kill it, lest he be merry. For this my son was dead, and is alive again, and he was lost, and was found, and they began to be merry. We'll stop there for sake of time. Let me pray with you again. Father, thank you for the holy and awesome and precious Word of God. And you know, Lord, that you prepared this. You prepared this last week. As I just see in this passage, in this son, the things that pop out to me in this awesome parable. As we look at heaven's mystery and then earth trying to explain it. And oh, the mystery of this homecoming. The mystery, God, why you do it. But it's going to happen one day. And Lord, I pray that you give us wisdom, give us understanding. God, I pray for the precious souls in this room. If someone's not truly born again, they don't know they're going to heaven. If they died right now, they have no idea if they'd go to heaven or hell. It's a doubt in their mind at the very moment I'm talking, God, that you would speak to them personally. Ain't nothing get done unless you do a personal work in a person's heart. Pray for backslidden Christians, God, that you would revive them again, bring them back to a place where they are restored unto you. And God, you give us wisdom. Give me unction. Give me power. I need it. God, you know my weaknesses. And I pray that you get glory and honor out of everything that's said and done tonight. We want to give it back to you. We thank you. We love you. In Christ's holy name. And everybody said, amen. Man, last week, like the first half of this parable, man, we dug in. We tried to preach it and teach it the best way I know how. And we were trying to dissect these parables going through them. I told Katie, I said, man, to hang on to one parable for 3 weeks in a row, man, is that too much? I don't want to hang around. Man, there's so much in this. And she said this, and I'll never forget it. She said something like this. She says stuff smarter than me all the time. I just never can remember. She said, do you think you can get everything that you want accomplished or something like this out of this parable if you just preach it two parts? And that's what stuck with me all day. And I said, Lord, I can't do this. You got to shut it or open the door. And he shut it. Because as soon as I hung up the phone with her, things started happening. I'd have a chance to go back and write down and study out this second son. So this is where we're at. We're in homecoming land, right? We're in homecoming land. Last week we looked the first half of this parable. If you didn't get it, you can go back. We have a YouTube channel, Builders on the Rock, and you can watch that. I widened out the screen. Mr. Ed Pelfer gave me that. He said, you're so small up on my TV screen. Widen it out. He said, it's much better. So we widened out. You can go back and look at that and watch that and catch up to us. Because last week it was, you're far from home. You're far from home, this son. And just to recap just a little bit, I can't re-preach it, don't have time. Then remember the reason. We looked at two other parables right before this that talked about a lost sheep and a lost coin. That lost sheep signifying that he left the 99 sheep that he had and went and found the one that was lost. He cared so much about the one that he said, I'll leave the ones that are safe and sound because I love that one. It shows that, hey, God wants us to be a part of the family. And then he said, this one coin, I mean, think of this. A lady has 10 coins and she loses one of them. I mean, that's 10%. I mean, you got another 90% of your money you can still use, but she said she left that and she went and got that one coin out of the 10, meaning that there's worth in you. That coin signifies that there's worth in you. Regardless if you think it or not, God thinks it enough. He knows that he's got the 9 secured, and you're worth going and searching even though he's got the 9 there. We've seen this reason that there was something lost and God's going to find it. The reality of this parable is that there's 2 sons. That we always focus on the prodigal son. That's what it's named. I named it the father's son, just trying to be biblical. But there's 2 sons. And then do you know that God dedicates 7 verses at the end of it? 7 whole verses just talking about the other son, but we rarely hear about it. We're going to hear about it next week or week after. I don't know what I'm going to do with that yet. But there's 2 sons. The reality is there's 2 sons. The reward. You remember the reward? The inheritance was this one boy's reward. And he got the reward and he's like, I'm going out partying, man. He goes into a far country and he spends it all. But last week I wanted to remind us that there's not only a reward that's good, but there's reward for things that we do bad. You see, this is what I wrote down just in my thought process. The inheritance was there. He had all this money. But watch, the reward of sin always takes the reward of goodness away. I mean, everything he got from his father, all the money that he got, the reward of sin takes it all away. You say, well, reward, I should get something. Yeah, I know. But there's a reward of iniquity. And it always wipes away that which God has given as a blessing. Always does. And then remember the recognitions where we left off. And just listen to these 3 things. I wrote them down. He came to himself. Remember, there was truth within. There was true worth that he found, and then the trick was worthless. Do you remember that? He found the truth within himself. And I'm going to tell you, if you're ever going to get a hold of Jesus the way you should get a hold of Jesus, it's got to be personal, and it's got to be just you. It can't be me telling you. It can't be your mom and dad telling you. It's got to be personal just in you. Because if you get personal with Jesus, you'll read your Bible when no one else is looking. Yeah. You'll make yourself have a prayer life. You'll say, Jesus, you're my all in all. If it gets within you and it's personal to you. There's a truth within, a true worth. And then the trick was worthless. I love that. But I guarantee you that as he walked back and started back his homeward bound trip that we're going to look at today, this homecoming, there wasn't a thing going to stop him. There wasn't I'll give you a job in this far land again. There wasn't anything going to stop him. And when you get a hold of Jesus, and when I get a hold of Jesus, and when we get right with him, there ain't a trick of this world that's going to make you say, I'll fall into that sin and get away from Jesus. Yeah. I'll go this way if it takes me away from Jesus. There won't be a single thing. The trick won't be, it'll be worthless to you. You couldn't make me take a sip of stuff today. You couldn't make me anything. You couldn't pay me enough money. Here's $1 million. Walk away from the faith. Keep it. My God owns that anyway. He'd give it to me if he wants to. You say, all these tricks will be worthless to you. Now look at the homecoming. Look at the homecoming. And oh, the day that will be. Now you guys, I get it. I was a teenager once. Now I wasn't in church when I was a teenager much. But when we talk about homecoming, we're not talking about heading to the house after church is over. Y'all know that? Let's talk about homecoming that, oh, we're going to have a family reunion. We're going to have a homecoming. We're all going to come together. The Gaither Band used to have homecomings where they get all these different bands together and have homecoming. That's not the homecoming we're talking about. This is not our home. Do you guys realize that the earth that you live in, the school that you go to, the house that you park underneath them, I'm telling you, it is not your home. Do you realize that? Do you realize that one day he is going to call us out of this world? But you know, we get so comfortable, don't we? I think that's why we like to hang on so much. That old saying says that that preacher said, I try not to hold on to things in this world too tight so it doesn't hurt so bad when God rips them out of our hand. Because the things of this world, man, they're never going to last. They're temporal. They're never going to last. And there's a homecoming. There's a day that God, we get comfortable in this world. That's why we would say, well, I'm just thinking of the teenagers. Right now, I'm ready, man. I'm 40 years old. I got some kids. I've lived a life. Man, I'm ready to say, God, you call me home. Anytime, man, you come get us. It's going to be great. But I know there's teenagers sitting here going, well, now I kind of want some things to do. Why? We get a little comfortable in some things. We get a little comfortable in this world. I was like that. I wrote a couple things there. We get interested in its lights, the flashiness of the world. Man, this is fun. There's some entertainment to this. We get entrenched in its lusts. But man, we like to do things of this world so bad that the lust of it are so important to us, but man, we don't want to go home right now. And then there's sometimes we're captivated by its longings. Everybody longs for this and longs for that. Man, we want the new thing here and the new thing there. And man, the highest and better and best. And man, I want the new iPhone 45 or something, whatever it is now. Or is it iPhone Z? I know it's got to get there somewhere. There's longings and we're captivated by it. And so when Jesus finally calls us, there may not be someone ready in this room. I'm not ready to meet him. Well, you better be ready because I'm telling you, there's a homecoming and it's coming.
Yeah.
We've forgotten we're not a part of this world. Teenager, listen to me, young person. Listen, you're not a part of this world. Amen. If you're saved,
yes.
You're not a part of this. You are going to go home one day. We may get down in this world. We may get discouraged and depressed, but there's going to come a day, a homecoming, where we lay our burdens down. We don't have to struggle anymore. A day you don't have to say no to sin. There ain't going to be none up there. You ain't got to take apart your life and think, man, I gotta stop this and start. I mean, it's gonna be a perfect home in heaven. That's our home. I mean, you ever go over to a friend's house and things are weird? You sleep and there's smells. Can I get a witness? You know, you go to your friend's house. Some of you are honest, but you go to someone else's house. You say, man, I can't wait. Me and my wife, we leave on trips, hour and a half, 2 hours long, and by the time we get home, we say, why'd I ever leave this place? You know, we're like, man. Five kids in a little car driving 2 hours. I'm telling you, we get home, we say, thank God we're home. Hey, we struggled. You're going to struggle. You're going to say, man, what is going on in this world? It's crazy. It's nuts. I got to be a light in a dark, dark place. I'm telling you, because it is not our home.
Yeah.
We're going to fly away one day. We're going to fly away one day. We're going to go to home. And that's where we're going to be comfortable. We're going to get there and we're going to say, I'm never going to leave this place. I often wonder how Paul did it. He said he was caught up to the third heaven. And said he saw things. You look this up, 2 Corinthians chapter 11, I think, or 12. He said, I've seen things that are not lawful for me to utter. And I just seen some people say, some people say they went to heaven and came back down. I'm telling you, I don't think they can handle it.
Yeah.
To go home and then have to come back to this world, I'm telling you, I don't think they can handle it. And so there's going to be a homecoming. But look at this homecoming. Look at this chapter. Look at it. This homecoming of this son. Now remember, he's in a far land. Remember, he took everything that his father gave him as an inheritance before his father died, gave him all the money he was supposed to have, and he went out and he blew it. He went out and he spent every little bit. And then as he got done spending everything that his father gave him, said, there's a famine in the land. And then he started being one. And he said he went to the hogs and started eating hog food. Actually, he started eating what the hogs wouldn't eat. And he came to himself. Look at verses. Look at verse 18. Look at the Bible. He says this. I will arise. Or verse 17. I'm sorry. And when he came to himself, he said, how many hired servants of my father's have bread enough to spare, and I will perish with hunger. He said, I will arise. He's talking to himself. I will arise and go to my father and will say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before thee. I am no more worthy to be called thy son. Make me as one of thy hired servants. I want you to see. Here it is. Number one, the repentance. Of this man. The repentance of the man. Look at verse 20. What? First three words. Read it with me. What's it say? And what?
He arose.
You see, and he arose. You see, repentance means that you turn completely from what or where you were or doing. You go complete opposite of that. That's repentance. You got sin that grips you. You got sin that gets a hold of you. You got a lifestyle that you should not be living because you're a saved individual. Things you should not be looking at. Repentance means you stop doing it now and you repent and you go the opposite. That means you don't do it no more.
Yep.
Come on now. That doesn't mean that you just stop it for a week.
Yep.
That doesn't mean you stop it just because you got caught. That means you have a complete repentance and you turn from it and it's completely opposite.
Yep.
This man was down. This man was in the mud. This man was in the muck, in the mire. He was eating with the hogs. He was at the end of his rope. And watch this. He arose. You see, he was laying down, and the Bible says he arose. He got up. He did opposite. You know what the opposite of laying down is? Getting up. All right? And they wrote this in my language, and he got himself up out of there. You know what I mean? He got up. He rose. The complete opposite of down. Now watch this. He could have just thought about repenting. He did. Look at the verses, verse 18. He said, I will rise. He's talking to himself. I'm going to rise, go to my father. He could have just thought about it. He could have wanted to repent.
Yeah.
I mean, he could have been there. I need to go back to my father. I need to go back to this. I need to get out of this mess that I'm in. He could have longed to do it. He could have thought, man, it's a good idea to repent. Come on, help me out now. He could have said, man, look at where I'm at. And he could have just went, man, it'd be an awful good idea if I got up out of this thing and went back. He could have even said, what's a good idea? Others could have said, you probably better get out of that thing. Dude, did you know that you're eating with hogs and hogs are one of the most dirty animals in the planet? Do you know what you're doing? Others could have came and said, you need to get out of there. But it would have never helped him to truly repent unless he did. Listen to this thing. I made this one up all by myself. Until he did, he did. That preach right there. Thank you, Tyler. Until he did, he didn't. Until he did repent, he didn't. Well, I wanted to. Romans 2:4, you can write that down, we will go to it. It says, the goodness of God leadeth thee to repentance. See, God's given you and given me, every one of us, this thing called free will. Say that.
Free will.
He's given us a free will to choose. You can choose whatever direction you want. You can choose any avenue of life you want. You can choose any sin you want. You can do anything you want. That's free will he's given you. But the Bible says that God, the goodness of God leadeth thee to repentance. Why? Because the only reason that he hasn't taken me out is because he's let me have space to repent.
Yeah.
Isn't that amazing? He continues to give you and me space. He doesn't take you out. He doesn't say that's enough. He can't make you repent, but he can hold judgment back so you can. He can't make you repent, but the goodness of God can hold judgment back. He can say, well, I'm not going to get him yet. I'm going to let him repent. Before I got right with God, God sent me some people. He sent me a man of God in my life. He sent me a cousin in my life. He sent some people dying in my life, some friends of mine dying. He's trying to get a hold of me. He sent a preacher in my life. Until finally he said, okay, you've had your space to repent. Now I'm going to bring judgment down on you because you're not repenting. And until I did, I didn't. I tried to hide it. I tried to turn away from it. I tried to say, well, I'll do that later. And God said, the goodness of God will lead me to repent. Hey, it'll lead you to repent too.
Yeah.
Some of us sit in our holy chairs and think, man, I got this is for everybody else. You go preach it then. Well, I'm going to tell you what. If you ain't got a hold of something yet in your heart, it's because you're not listening to God.
Mm-hmm.
I got stuff I got to repent of. I'm sure there's some things we got to repent of that we sit back in our list of things to do. We put it way down on the list after our chores, after our homework. So I'll get to that, God. I'll get to it later. I'm 13, I'm 14, 15, 12 years old. Why are you getting a hold of me now? Because that's it. I want to lead you to repentance. On that judgment. You have to. Look, it's not that it's a good idea. You may want to. There may be others telling you. Like a guy spitting at a pulpit. Come on. But you have to do it. True repentance is taking it out. Now this girl is when we had the wall right here. See, thank you, man. I can walk down here. Freedom! We had a wall right here. See, y'all wouldn't have been part of the class right now. But there's a wall right here. And I preached. I had the pulpit right here. And I chaired. We had two rows of chairs out here. And never forget this. I called her or texted her today. Taylor Hatfield. And I said, hey, I want to use you in an illustration. Can I say your name? She said, yeah, you can say my name. I told her what it was about, but I'll never forget this because I witnessed true repentance, I think, for the first time in youth group. But I was preaching. I can't remember what I was preaching, but I was preaching. Man, I'm huge on that thing when I get it back here. But I was preaching, and at the end of the service, we had an invitation. You know that thing where you do business with God?
Mm-hmm.
And I remember Taylor Hatfield coming down, and she took her belly button ring out. Because, by the way, Christians aren't supposed to have those things.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Christians aren't supposed to have those things.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You say, well, where's that in the Bible? Well, you want to sit down with me, I'll show you. But most people don't want to sit down. So show you. Anyway, she took it out, she goes, here. And I'm like, I absolutely do not want one of those. And I'm like, just set it right there. With the pulpit. But I'll never forget that. I'll never forget it. It was right here. I was right here. The pulpit was right here. And she came up to me right here. She was praying over here. And she got up and she turned herself. And took it out, thank God. And she turned herself, and she goes, here. And I said, I didn't know she had been. I had no idea. But she got a hold of something. And she repented. She said, no more. I'm not going to do it anymore. I want now. Look, it may not, that may not be your fault. I don't know. But I'm going to tell you, she had true repentance. He found, this man found within himself true worth. And it wasn't the sin he was hanging on to. When you find true worth, it won't be the sin that you're hanging on to. The true worth in you will be you repenting of that sin. That's when you'll find true worth. And I'm telling you, get a hold of repentance. We start this homecoming out. But obviously, this son had to repent. He rose. He got up out of the muck and mire. He said, I'm going to do something about that. Believe it or not, that was the shortest point of these three. Look at number two. You ready? Look at the reaction of the father. There's repentance of the son. Look at the reaction of the father. Verse number 20 said, he arose, came to his father. But when he was yet a great way off, his father saw him, had compassion, and ran, fell on his neck, and kissed him. I don't know about you, but I look at that verse, and it just comes out of me. Sometimes I think that we misunderstand some things about God. I think sometimes we get to find ourselves, watch this, where we want to go back, but we're afraid of the reaction if we do. I want to get right. I want to repent. I want to get back to where I need to be with God. But then what is the youth director going to say? What's my parents going to say? What's my friends going to say? Where we're scared of the reaction. We're scared of what will happen. We want to get right, but we're like, if I get right, what is going to happen? What are they going to say? What's God going to do? And look at the reaction of the father. Look at his position. A. Look at his position of the father. Look at this. It's amazing to me. Said he rose and came to his father. But when he was yet a great way off. Sorry. It says he wasn't just off. Like I am sometimes, right? I mean, he wasn't just off. He wasn't just way off. It said he was a great way off. The position of the father's reaction, he wasn't close. I mean, he was distant. Isaiah chapter 59 verse 1 says, the Lord's hand is not shortened that it cannot save. It's not shortened that it cannot save. You know what that means? That means God's hand goes way, 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 way. There's an old song I used to listen to when I first got right with God. Said, when he had to reach way down for me. I was lost and undone without God and his son, but he had to reach way down for me. Psalm chapter 139, verse number, let me read these verses to you. I got to look at verse 7. It says, whither shall I go from thy spirit? Or whither shall I flee from thy presence? If I ascend up into heaven, thou art there. If I make my bed in hell, behold, thou art there. If I take the wings of the morning and dwell in the uttermost parts of the sea, even there shall thy hand lead me, and thy right hand shall hold me. You see, the position of the father, he's seen him while he was a great way off, because God says, I'll go way over. Yeah. And what that tells me is the father wasn't sitting in the house stewing over his son. That as that father opened that door every day, or as he was out working in the fields, or he was out doing something, his eyes were toward the road looking, and he said, as he was a great way off, his position, that father said his reaction, as a great way off, he was looking for his son to come back. Look at his perception. His perception. It said he was a great way off. Look at your Bible. Look at verse 20. But when he was yet a great way off, his father, what's it say, class?
Saw him.
The perception. It wasn't a surprise, as I said earlier. He was expecting. Always looking. If I'm not expecting someone to come in our driveway, I'm not looking for them. But man, if they're not there. The other day, Katie took a little longer softball practice. Man, I'm like, where's my girls at? All of them were gone. I'm just there with a bunch of boys, man. About time to get some peace in that house, man. Bring some estrogen in there, man. I'm like, this is us boys, man. We're up and tough right now. But I was expecting, I was looking. What he said, he was a great part. His perception was he saw his awful state, too. Could you imagine being, I've seen a guy have a week worth of binge and heroin in Columbus. He was in Columbus in a crack house for a week, and he showed up at the office door of the church. That was a week. I don't know how long that guy was gone. But he was swimming with the pigs before he came home. And guys, they don't have motels you can stop and take showers in back then. Could you imagine him walking back? Could you imagine the hot and dusty road where he's sweating and he's got filth all over him? And the father said his perception is he saw his awful state. He was dirty. He was unclean. But his reaction was still the same. Even though he had the filth of the world all over, his reaction was still the same. Zechariah 4:10 says the eyes of the Lord go to and fro on the earth. Proverbs 15:10 says the eyes of the Lord are in every place. So there is nothing he hasn't seen, teenager. There ain't nothing that he hasn't looked at or perceived that you have seen or listened to. There ain't a thing that you're hiding from him. And the filth of this world and our hands, our heart, our eyes, our ears, it's all open before him. The Bible says it's open and it's naked before him. He sees it all. But his reaction when we want to come back to him is still the same. It's amazing to me. I'm thinking, God, but you know what I've been through. He says, I know. And I perceive it already, and I saw it already, and my reaction will still be the same. I can't come back to God. Look what I've done. God said, I'm just waiting. I'll see you right before way off. I'll see it all. Amen. He sees everything. And his reaction is still the same. Look at C. Look at his pardon. He came to his father when he was yet a great way off. His father saw him and had compassion. He's pardoned. The word compassion means to feel sympathy or pity. Romans 11:33 says, oh, the riches and depths of the knowledge of God. See, this father didn't have a grudge. He didn't hang it over his head. His compassion was so deep, he gave pardon to his son. It ran so deep. If you will just understand how much Jesus loves you. We were talking about Bible study on Monday night with Jalen Austin. I said, there's two judgments in this world. There's a white throne judgment, and I'm begging none of you have to face that one. Been enough preaching, you've been in your church now, you got a chance to avoid that. There's a white throne judgment. And I said this, and we went through it, taught it, and I'll teach that to you later. But I said, this white throne judgment, you're going to get judged because of your sin. This judgment is for the Christian. And I asked this question to him. It's a trick question, Jay Lawson. Yes, but I asked this question. I said, how many sins does God see now? Or something like, how many sins do you have to pay for now? And they were like, man, a bunch. Mm-hmm. I'm like, you wicked sinners. No, I'm sure. I was like, oh, I'm going to do that. Listen to me. There is none. Yeah. Do you all understand that? Mm-hmm. I know you're not perfect. My wife knows I'm not perfect. But when we stand before a holy God, we're pardoned. Yeah. I don't think he got it yet. Because I think if we got it in our day and age in America, if we got it in the Church of the Living God, there'd be a lot more people weeping at altar saying, thank you, Jesus. He's pardoned us. And he says, your sin I will remember no more. But wait a minute, I remember that sin. I know, but God doesn't remember it. Why? How is that possible? The precious and awesome blood of Jesus. The cross of Calvary paid it all. Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. Sin had left the crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. And the moment that you trusted Christ is the moment that he wiped away all the sin in your past and all the sin that you've ever done. You stand before him clean. A white robe of righteousness on you. That is amazing. Yeah. And this father, when he said, I've seen that great, he said, I had compassion, I had pardon on him. It didn't matter what he had on him. He said, I pardoned it all. Look at this. D, look at the patience that he had. Look at the patience that he had. Look at verse 20. It said he arose and came to his father, but when he was yet a great way off, his father saw him, had compassion, and what? Man. He didn't have patience. He didn't. He definitely said he ran. That word ran means to be with haste. He didn't take off on a jog. He didn't stand at the door and say, I'm just going to wait for him to crawl his way to there. When he seen his son, he didn't. Now watch. He had patience to wait for him to come back and he could search him. But when he seen him a great far way off, when he seen him turn, when he seen him coming down, he said, I'm not going to stand here. I'm going to run. I'm not going to wait for him to drag himself. He went to him. James 4:8 says, you draw nigh to God, what? He'll draw nigh to you. Believe it. If you get right and get back where you should be, God will look down on you. He won't give you. He won't look down on you. He won't give you a lecture. He comes to where you are. His position of reach will reach down to hell. It'll reach to heaven. He'll meet you there. He'll meet you wherever you are. You say, well, I'm so far away from where I'm supposed to be. Well, God knows you're that far away. And all he is waiting for you to do is turn. And the instant you turn, his patience is up and he'll run through you. But he's waiting for you. He had no patience at all. Look at Eve. His passion. Man. Watch what it says. Last part first. He fell on his neck and kissed him. I was going to say something about face. Some dogs I've kissed before, and you know, it's disgusting. You know how you get it. But not really. But do you realize this isn't a formal show? What Jesus is trying to portray here in this parable is this father didn't go, hug me. Oh, it's so good to see you, son. I do a little side hug. Love you. And Jesus is trying to show his passion the Father had. It said he fell on his neck. I don't know if you've ever seen it, but when two people haven't seen each other, they usually don't stand too long. Their knees are weak. I missed you so much, and they fall, hug him. He said he fell on his neck and kissed him. Say he kissed him. Why did Jesus kiss him? Why did you say he fell on his neck and wept? It wasn't formal, is it? He wanted us to see a show of an undying, undimming, and undeterred love for his broken hearted son. He said, I want to show him passion. Acts chapter 1, verse 3, the only time the word passion ever is seen in Scripture, it says this. That Jesus, after his passion, after his crucifixion, the word passion means to have a sensible experience or the suffering of the cross. He was willing to suffer through the dirt and grime and the filth of this world in order to be close to his son. He said, you know, I've got such a passion for my son that as I've seen him come down the road and I've seen his filth, I've seen everything, my passion is so great for him that I want to have a sensible experience. I fell on his neck and I kissed him, the passion that he showed. Mm-hmm. Jesus, thank you. Mm-hmm. Amen. Mm-hmm. If you've been saved, you ought to thank Jesus that he didn't care about the filth that was on you. That his passion, his cross, his dying, his resurrection, his suffering, his beating, his crown of thorns was placed upon his head. And he did it all because he said, I want to cover you. I have a passion for you. I want to have a sensible experience so that I can see you and say, hey, I've got passion for you, world. I loved you. I gave myself for you. His father said, I'm going to show you I've got passion. He fell on him and he kissed his neck. You see the reaction of the father. Number three, you ready? Let's look at the restoration of the son. The repentance of the son. Do you see the reaction of the father? Now look at his restoration. I think I can do this. Look at it. Verse number 21. He said this. So, A, underneath there, if you're taking notes, the restoration of the son. A, look at the humbleness of the son. Verse 21. I finally got to another verse. You see why I had to be three points? I don't know how. Look, verse 21 said, the son said unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and in thy sight. That phrase right there, I'm going to preach that. That's going to be the third part. I'm going to show you something. I've never seen it before, if I'm going to preach it to you, but watch. Can't do it tonight. Says, I have sinned against heaven in thy sight, and am no more worthy to be called thy son. Hey, he did in the loneliness and the truth that it came within him when he came to himself, and he said, I'm going to have true repentance. True repentance means when you think it in your head, he thought it, and he said, I'm going to do this, and he did exactly what he said he was going to do. He goes to him, and he has a humbleness. He said, I'm no more worthy to be called thy son. But the Father said to his servants, he had a humble spirit. He didn't come. He came expecting to be a servant. He didn't come thinking he was going to be anything. He didn't come to the Father thinking, well, I know I want to be like, I want to say I want to be a servant, but man, I know Dad's really going to take care of me. He didn't think that. He said, I am no more worthy to be called your servant. And watch this. James chapter 4, verse 10. The Bible says to humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God, and he shall lift you up. Pride has no place. And pride will keep you from repenting of sin. Pride will keep you from falling on your face before God. Pride will keep you from doing anything God wants you to do. And this man had a humble spirit about him. And he said, I'm humble before you, Father. I'm no more worthy to be called your son. The restoration starts with the humbleness in our own hearts and our own lives, doesn't it? I'm not doing anything wrong right now. You're not. What in the world am I preaching for? I don't got anything to repent. Do I got to come back to the Father? Well, how's your relationship with God? Did you used to read your Bible more? Like my wife said earlier, if you're not what you used to be, you're backslidden. How's the prayer life? Does that phone take up more of your time than the Bible does? Y'all hearing this? You say, I got nothing to repent of. You don't? You want me to keep going or should I go on? There's a humbleness. Don't be prideful in who you are. Will, don't be prideful in who you are. I hear you. B, look at the heart of the Father. Not only is there a humbleness of the Son, look at the heart of the Father. Am I going too fast? Am I going too fast? Verse 22. The Father said to his what? You know, I don't have time to preach this, but do you realize that God, the Father tells the people that the Son said he wanted to be? Go to John chapter 15. I'm going to take you there. I wasn't going to do this, but it's just the next book over. Go to John 15. Yeah, John 15. Look at verse number 15. They said to us that the very type of people the Son thought he would become, he told them to prepare something for this Son. Watch this. Look at John 15:15. One of the most amazing verses in Scripture. You ready? Henceforth, I call you what?
Not servants,
for the servant knoweth not what his Lord doeth, because he just goes by command. See, a servant doesn't know what his Lord doeth. He's not in his inner circle. He said, I'm not calling you servants. Because the servant don't know what he's doing. He just waits for the command and goes. He said, y'all get this? But I have called you what?
Friends.
Man, that's good. The God of heaven said, I don't want you just to be a servant. In fact, that's not what I made you for. He said, I'm going to call you friends. For all things that I have heard of my Father, I have made known to you. Watch this, verse 16. Ye have not chosen me, but I have chosen you and ordained you. You are a friend of God, chosen out of the world. John 3:16. For God so what? Loved the world that he gave his only what?
Son.
You see, he loves you. So I'm not calling you a servant. I'm not calling you a hired hand. I'm not calling you someone that I just can give commands to. No, no, no. You're in my inner circle. No, 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 you are not a servant, but I'm not worthy to be called your son anymore. And the Father said, hey, servants, that's not you, you're my son. Servants, go get this stuff for me. The heart of the Father is God's, now listen, God's not waiting to restore you, he's waiting on you to want to be restored. He's not waiting to restore you. You say, I want to be restored to God. God says, I know, I'm waiting for you to want to be restored, and I will bring you back to where I intended you to be. is calling out to you, and he's saying, this ain't where you're supposed to be in your life, teenager. This ain't where you're supposed to be in your life, Christian. You are supposed to be better than this. I've saved you out of this world, and the heart of the Father is, I haven't called you this servant. I've called you my friend. Chosen you out of the world. I've ordained you to do something more mighty than what you're doing with your life right now. And I look at the healing. This is amazing. I have absolutely no time to preach this, but I look at it. The Father said, verse 22, go back to John or Luke 15. Could you imagine if I had to preach about the other son? I couldn't do it, right? Watch, verse 22. The Father said unto his servants, watch. Bring forth the best robe, put it on, and put on a ring on his hand, and shoes on his feet, bring hither the fatted calf, and kill it, and let's eat. And be merry. Look at the healing right here. You ready? He told him to put on a robe to cover up his filth. Bring not just the robe that people, he said, bring the set. Come on, what's your Bible say?
Best robe.
The best robe. Don't get the one that's in a dirty laundry room already, like Elvin likes to pick out and try to wear pants in our house. I got the pants. Oh, there's something right. You don't get that. He said, get the best robe we got in the house, and you bring it and you cover him up. 1 Peter 4:8 says, charity covereth a multitude of sins. You see, the healing was, the Father said, cover it all up. I don't want them walking around people with, oh man, look what he got on. He said, I'll cover it all up. I'll cover it up with my best robe.
Yeah.
And healing started. He put on a ring on his finger. Mercy. A ring put him back to a place of authority. Y'all know what they did with rings back in? It wasn't enough gifts to show your wedding. They used to have rings that would be the family honor. It would have a family emblem on it, and they would seal letters with it so that you would know what family he was from. And the Father said, put a robe on him, then put the ring back. Put the seal of the family back on him. Put it back on. I want everyone to know he's my son. I want everyone to know that he is back in the place of authority in my house again. I want that seal of my family to be back on him. Now listen to me. If you're saved, you can't be unsaved. You can't get the Holy Spirit out of you. God has promised it and come in you and be with you forever. But here's what David said in Psalm 51. He said, take not that Holy Spirit from me. And he said, return unto me the joy of thy salvation. That moment he put that ring back on his finger, that Father said, that's just my seal. I just want everybody to know he's in my family now. Yeah. But wait a minute. No, he just got out of the world. He just spent all your money. He said, I know he did, and I put my best robe on him, and I put the ring back on his finger. I put that seal that he's in my family, and you better believe he's in my family, and I want everyone to know he's in my family. Mm-hmm. And then he told him to put on some shoes. What in the world shoes? What? The dude is barefoot, yeah. And the world cut him up. As he walked down the roads, the rocks hurt his feet. So he said, I want you to put shoes on him so he can walk through this world and not be hurt. John 17, verse number 14 says, I have given them thy word, and the world hateth them because they are not of the world, even as I am not of the world. Jesus himself said that when you become a child of God, you are not supposed to be in this world. He said, because I'm not in this world, and you're supposed to be a Christian, Christ-like. But watch this next verse. Verse 15 says, I pray not that thou shouldest take them out of the world, but that thou shouldest keep them from the evil. This son came back, he had the world all over him, and he said, I want you to cover that stuff up. I want you to put that ring back on his finger so people know he's part of my family again, because he's my blessed son, and I want you to put shoes on his feet, because he's not going to come out of this world. He's got to walk through it still, but I don't want it to cut him up anymore. I want him to be able to walk through it. I don't want you to take him out of the world, Father, but I want you to keep him from the world. I don't want them to be of the world. Taylor Hatfield, she decided one day, I'm not going to be of the world. I'm not going to be a part of this world. I'm going to repent of sin. And she took the ring out and she said, ring the things that never should be a part of her life anyway. And now she's teaching my kids in Awana. I'm going to say that's restoration. I'm going to say that's what God does. I'm going to say, when she thought, man, what's going to happen when I hand this to Will? I don't know what she thought that day, but she said, I am going to make sure that I'm right with Jesus and that He is going to use me and restore me to a position in His family. And then man gave her shoes. She can walk through this world as He'll give you shoes that you can walk through this world. And man, we got to be in it, but not of it. You're not supposed to be of it. And He gave him shoes. He said, walk through the world. Here's your shoes. And then gave him a steer. Now, if you ever get beat cut up, you ever get beat cut, get a steer. Because they got more muscle on them. That's the steaks. Come on now. Am I offending some vegetarians in here? I don't know. I seen this shirt the other day. There may be someone in here, but that's okay. I eat meat, but I identify as vegetarian. So it's all right. That was a joke, but you're okay. But there, he gave him a steer. What's this? He gave him the satisfaction of God. He took the fatted calf, the best thing, the meat that was supposed to be prepared for a big feast, and he said, my son's back. The world has chewed him up and spit him out, as it will do you. And he ain't got no satisfaction. He's hungry. He's been eating from the hogs. He said, I want to show him what satisfaction is. Psalm chapter, I don't know if I wrote it. I maybe wrote it on that paper. But Psalm, I think, 81:10. Is that what it says on there? Did I write that down?
Yeah.
81:10. God says, Israel, open your mouth wide and I'll fill it. Jeremiah chapter 31, verse 25 says, He satisfies the soul. And when He gave him that steer, what He was telling him is that, look, I'll satisfy you. You've been out too long. You've been going too long. You've been going too far. You've been trying to do too many things to try to satisfy you, and it ain't satisfied yet. And I'm going to tell you don't have to experience that. You don't have to be a part of that. You don't have to go to the world for satisfaction. God said, if you open your mouth wide, I'll fill it. He said, I will satisfy the thirsty soul. He that hunger and thirst, blessed is he that hunger and thirst after righteousness, for he shall be what? Filled. Killed the fat calf. It's one of the greatest stories I've ever seen. When a man will repent, the reaction of the Father, and then the restoration that takes place in his life. And I'll take place in yours too. How are you with God? I want to challenge you a little bit. I don't want you to go to a far out land. You're trying to walk away from the Father right now. God's trying to get a hold of you right now and say, turn around. Stop where you're at and turn around and come back. But I've already taken this inheritance and I've got this money. That's okay. Turn around and come back. The Father's waiting for you. He's standing there watching you walk away. And He said, all you got to do is turn. He'll put a robe on you and cover it up. He'll put you, say, look, I'm proud of Him. Here's His ring. Here's shoes for your feet so when you walk in the world, you don't have to. And I'll satisfy your soul. Try Jesus. I'm telling you, God's calling. Are you listening? Every head bowed, every head closed in the house. Father, thank you for your holy and precious word tonight. God, I've done what I can to try to portray your word and give it in a way that you give it to me. Thank you, Father, for restoring me. Thank you for giving me hope again. Thank you for taking a sinful, wicked man, and I'm giving up on me. Instead, you just said, here, I'm going to keep pulling, I'm going to keep calling. Thank you for restoration. And tonight, in this house, you say, well, I don't know that I'm saved. That judgment, there won't be a judgment seat, there will be a white throne judgment, you're going to have to stay for one day. You're going to have to pay for all your sin. And you don't have to tonight. Jesus paid it all. He died on the cross. He was buried and resurrected. So that you can have life and have it more abundant. You say, well, I don't know. I'm saying, I don't care if you've come to this church since the day you were born. I don't care if you've come here every Wednesday for a year. Listen to me. If you're not saved, you know what I'm asking you. Are you saved? You say, well, I'm not saved. Would you pray for me? That's me. Would you pray for me? Is anybody like that in the house? No one else look around, just me. You just lift your hand up and trust me and say, well, you pray for me. I won't call you out. I won't say your name. Find out. I just want to pray for you. I appreciate it. I got you. Thank you. pray for you. Anybody else say that? Well, I don't know. Come on. Thank you for your honesty. God in heaven, I come before you humbly. And without warrant, I can't, without Jesus' blood, I'm asking this in Jesus' name, that those that have raised their hand in this room, you're dealing with them in some way. God, I pray that they respond to the Holy Spirit of God tonight. Not respond to a preacher, but they respond to the Holy Spirit of God. I ask you to do a miracle in this room tonight. Just continue to draw them. I can't make them. I can't push them, but you got me. So you raised your hand. You didn't raise your hand tonight. I prayed for you. I just did it in Jesus' name. Just did it. Ask this question. What would stop you from knowing for sure you can go to heaven? Would anything keep you in that seat? If I could tell you you can know for sure you go to heaven and avoid hell tonight, would anything keep you in there? Ask that question in your mind. The answer is no. I want you to do something for me. You ready? I want you to show Jesus, show God you're serious. In the back by the door is my wife, Kate. She would love to show you. Man, woman, child, doesn't matter. How to be saved. And that's what I'm asking you to do. I'm asking you to show Jesus you're serious. If you raise your hand, you didn't raise your hand, you said, well, it's me, I need to get saved. I want you to get up out of your seat. Just walk to the back. Say, I need to be saved. Your friend will go with you if you want to take them. They will. But why don't you go? I'm going to give you a second, and we'll keep going. Anybody tell you? Yeah. I'm not going to take baptize anybody. Come on. Spirit's moving. What you doing? How about you, Christian? I think there's some work we got to do. Father, you bless this invitation. This is for Christians now. May people come at a place of sacrifice. And God, may you have glory and honor. May you speak to us. You challenge us tonight. So God, you do something mighty and awesome in our presence. Thank you.